Later they were loaded in the trucks, two trucks, covered with canvas, and they moved on. In the front was a Jeep with a machine gun, in the back a Jeep with a machine gun, and we realized we are moving in the direction of Sobibor. But you see, hope, what would kill the Jewish people? Hope, maybe I will survive. And the same was in our case. Obviously, they're little children, old women. We can walk, but no, maybe they will take us to a concentration camp. Because, and the way from Izbica to Sobibor, 40 miles again, like the same distance like to Belgium. About halfway was an off-ramp to Osova, a concentration camp. So maybe they will take us to Osova. Everything is better than a dirt camp. And I remember this mass sight when we passed the off-ramp and the truck didn't turn, but we hoped. And I remember the conversations. We talk about resistance. Voices of young people saying, let's fight back, we will die anyway. Let's fight back. And on the other side, I hear voices from family men like my father. It's no use, we will die anyway. Let's die as a family. And so the trucks come to a stop, Sobibor.
But when I came in, I still had a pair of brown leather boots. And I looked around, and I looked at those Nazis. And it was explained to me by the commandant and by the previous inmates, what's going on. And I said to myself, with these boots, I have to run away from here.
I always was thinking one day I will be out. Really, I had the not a realistic idea, but somehow I was thinking we will come out of here. And it was the idea went around, different plans. Everybody has a lot of plans, but not really realistic plans. Till a transport came with Russian Jewish prisoners of war from Minsk, and I say we had ideas, different ones. And when they came, and there was among them was one captain in the Russian army. And when he heard...
What was his name again?
Sasha Petruski, I think. Yeah, Petruski. And when he came, he said, we told him what's going on here, so he wanted to run away this first day. So we told them, listen, that it's not so easy as you think. There's guards all over and mines around, things like that. So we told them we have plans on our own.
The plan developed when the Fellhandler came into the camp. He came.
When did he arrive about?
I would say I came in December. Shortly before Christmas, either March or April, March probably, or maybe even February. When he came and when he saw him, when we told him, he said there is a way. There has to be a way and we have to do it. Because he realized we don't have nothing to lose. And the revenge was such a big think in our hearts that we would have, every one of us would have given his life to take revenge.
Our only aim was to dream, to get out and to tell if we'll survive. But we were told later on when they organized the escape that even when one will survive of that nearly 500 people, the escape is going to be a success. So we never worried.
And you spoke about escape in that time?
No. We were not allowed to a word about. We were told, when the time will come, you will be told. But in the meantime, nothing. Because you didn't know who was going to tell the Germans what's going on. So they had to be so careful amongst themselves how it was going to be done and the way they did it. And it was a masterpiece.
When the Russian POWs came to us, our plan was ready to go. They just came in handy, like, you know, a gift from God. They were all together 28 days in camp, the Russian Jews. It took us probably 10 days to understand each other and to talk to each other and to start trusting each other. And when we could explain them the plan, they encouraged, and that's what we needed, you know? But they didn't give us the plan. They gained from us because we knew every corner, every inch in the camp. We knew every SS from inside out. We knew every Ukrainian. We knew when they sleep and when they eat and when they walk and when they lay, and we knew where they're going to be at this time. We had their schedule all, and we gave it to them. We knew how to cut the wires, like, we knew how to cut the telephone wires. We knew everything, because if you live with people for so long and so close, you get to know it. And they were so sure with us that they used to talk open. They didn't hide nothing.
Was everyone in the camp aware of all the planning?
No. We were afraid that if everybody would know, it would leak out and we'll all lose. So just a few, about 20 people. But we decided, being we saw what happened with the Waltz commander and before, that if one escapes, the others pay the price, we have to give everybody a chance. And we didn't have to pack luggage, and we didn't have to buy tickets, you know, to get ready. So we said, the last day, we'll tell everybody. And that's how it worked.
A small group only, and mostly was the Polish Jews, what they planned and they talked with Sasha, the group of his group. And the plan, they told him, as I say, you cannot run away just like that, has to be organized. And he organized a plan how to run away. It was planned for everybody. It was not a plan, just a few ran away or things like that. It was planned for the whole camp. So there was not, although there was secretive, but it was not to leave somebody, or normally leave somebody. There was planned the whole camp to go. And the plan was, we usually walk till 5 o'clock in the evening. And that time is it already starts to get dark. It was in October. So there was the plan was, an hour before we stopped working, the uprising will begin.
The plan was very simple. It was divided in two phases. The first phase, which should last from 4 to 5, was the killing of the Nazis, killing them quietly, without arousing any suspicion, with knives and axes. The second phase was that after killing, when we assemble for the roll call, we should explode and have an open revolt and use the guns which we did get from the killed Germans. How to kill the Germans? For now, from the perspective, I think it was very easy. You see, the Germans, the Pentagon and the guards and the towers and the Ukrainian guards, they themselves were the staff. And the sorting place where we were sorting, there was always a German, Wolf was his name, who didn't supervise we shouldn't escape, but he did supervise we should walk. And so on and other places too. So, but they were obligated, like the guards and the towers, to stay on the spot. They could go for a cup of coffee, they could go away. So if he killed one Nazi supervising the sorting of the shoes, then another Nazi who passed by, he didn't see him, he wasn't alarmed. So, and everything was running smooth with the capos that run everything. The legal, the regular flow was like that. 5 o'clock we finished the work, the capo whistled the whistle, and we assemble in groups and we march to the main yard. Over there we go to the kitchen to pick up our food. In 5:30, half an hour later, after we eat, was the roll call. That time, this was a dangerous time, because at that point on the roll call, all the Germans must come assemble in the counters. So actually, from 4 to 5, we could kill them very careful.
You know, I have today the impression that the Germans were too complacent. Everything was running so smooth that they were too complacent to think even about being more cautious to prevent an escape.
And then we were told the night before, be prepared, and if we had a little bit of changing of clothes, to put it all under so but it won't be suspected that we are a little bit bigger, because we were going in it. The 14th of October was late autumn in Europe, in Poland. So we had, and I still had my coat. I looked after it, I didn't wear it. I used to have it under my head. That was almost like a pillow to sleep on it. And I had my coat that day. I took it with me, even if it was not so cold, but I had it on, and I had a scarf, and I had a little bag and a few cubes of sugar that German gave me. I put into that bag.
For the next day. The next day, I was impatient. I was scared. I wasn't scared really to die, because I had time to get used to it. I was scared that I will suffer. We prisoners, we always said we will not go to the gas chamber. We rather want to be shot at. So I was aware, but shot, he will be wounded. So I prayed for a fast death. And I was scared.
And in the groups where I worked there was in the warehouse there, they called in, the German said there's something they want to ask him, and there was somebody there, and they killed him too and left him there. Now, there was one in the office, was a German, and he had to be killed. So there were two guys were appointed to do it. Now, one of them got scared. They said, I don't go. In the meantime, already 10 Germans were already killed. So I said, so Selma said to him, you have to go. We are no in a situation, it's no walk back. No, he said, I don't go, I am afraid. So I at once I become a big hero. I say, we have already so many killed. There's no way back. If we don't go through it, we're sure dead. So Selma gave me from the warehouse a kitchen knife, and I went together with the other fellow and went in, and we killed the German, and I jabbed him with the knife, and I said, this is for my father, for my brother, for all the Jews who were killed, and we killed him.
Then a Ukrainian biked into the camp. I think his name was Klat. And as soon as he was in the camp, a group of young kids surrounded him, threw him off the bike, and knifed him to death. And I went out and dragged him between two barracks in a narrow spot so that the guard, the Ukrainian guard on a tower, couldn't see him dead. I had blood on my hands at that time.
Anyway, by 5 o'clock, most of them were killed, of the Nazis.
And they didn't know about each other?
No, they didn't know. It was quiet. At 5 o'clock, as usual, a prisoner went to the tower and put a signal out with a trumpet at the end of the walk. The couples assembled it, like every day, because the rule was it should look like every day. And the two couples which were in the organization were ordered even to beat us. By us every day, if somebody slaughtered. And we were assembled in groups, and we marched to the kitchen, to the main yard. It's 5 o'clock. And now I remember when I marched in, I was shocked to see how many people don't know what's happened. When we were six, in that part of the camp, we were 500 in that time. If we were 500 people, I guarantee about 450 stand in the line for food, not knowing that practically 95% of Germans are killed. But now one told another one, and simple, and they were kissing each other. And I remember his daughter was 17, maybe he was 50 years old. Mm-hmm. He was a tailor, and I remember walking back and forth and holding his hand and breaking his fingers, you know. Why do we need it for? We could live another 2 weeks, another 3 weeks. Why do we need it for? You know, when you're close to die, every second is precious. You don't imagine. You had never the feeling. You will never understand it even.
And Bauer, another Schauführer, came from the third camp with a truck, and something had to be unloaded. I'm not so sure what it was there, and they couldn't find somebody because it was nearly roll call and finish of work. And then he went into an office, and he saw blood on a door or something, and that German was lying under the desk, dead. And then when the alarm was, and then the shooting started. And some of the boys and the men were impatient. They wanted to climb over the barbed wire, and they got shot on there. And then the boys started to cut the wire through so we could run. And the shooting, the most damage were done from the towers where the Ukraine guards were, because the Germans had only rifles or pistols. But the machine guns were up top in the towers, and they were four towers.
So in fact, roll call hadn't taken place yet?
No, it was 10 minutes before, and that tragedy happened. And maybe we would have got out a lot more of us. Maybe not all, but we would have, not that many would have been killed.
What happened to you then?
I started running. I wasn't far away from that opening they made in the fences. And on the way, there was somewhere a bush, because not only that, but from the camp to the forest, there was more than a kilometer clearing. And there was even some logs were lying there, and we had to jump over the logs and duck, you know, not the shooting, just to the opposite direction of the shooting. And then my little bag with a little bit of sugar I had got caught on a branch, and it wasn't time to untangle it, so I just let it go. And when I stopped running in the forest, turned around, there were a lot of us, hundreds I should say, and it was only three of us.
And then they set everybody on his own. I personally figured before, I'm not going to wait for, I don't need no weapons, I'm not going to the armory. I'm going to go over that fence behind the carpenters. And soon they started running and shooting. I just ran there, and there was a stepladder. Somebody put it up, and a lot of people had gone over already before it even started. And I jumped up the stepladder, and as I jumped up, I got a shot from a tower, from a Ukrainian.
And you were shot?
Yeah, you want to touch? Still there. And I started hopping over the dead bodies, and I made it to the woods.
And I ran along that row of buildings to that ladder. And I jumped over and into the field. And Schleimisch Neisner was behind me. He was the last one. I was the second last to escape in that spot. And I was walking fast through the meadow. And one of the two fellows who I protected all the time in the barracks, Josel Siegel was his name. He had frozen off toes. He couldn't walk too well. He walked but slow. How he got over, it's a miracle. Because he was an invalid. And he said to me, Kurt läuft, that means Kurt run. And I said to him, Josel, ich läuft nicht mehr, bin a freier Mensch. Josef, I don't run anymore, I'm a free man. That's how I felt. Of course, it was far from being free because there were so many dangerous things which had to be overcome up to the end of war, which I didn't realize at that time because I was drunk with my achievement of getting into freedom. And I landed in the forest.
So I got to Frankfurt, from Frankfurt to Hagen. And the next day I went to Hagen Court. And I walked into, was a big, big foyer in the court, and there was a man standing a little bit further than that wall, or the other wall there. And I said to Judge Kramer, what is Frenzel doing here? He looked at me, he wanted to introduce me to the translator. And there was a woman. And he looked at me, he said, how do you know that's Frenzel? I said, I just recognize him. He was standing there at the profile, the side, leaning on a cane. And he had not a raincoat, but all weather coat on. But when I looked at him, the first glance, and I recognized him after 40 years. And he was in civilian clothing, and all I knew him was in the military uniform. And they were, you know, I don't know how they, you know, that. But in court, there was that many questions they asked. And they had about six prosecutors, that many. And Frenzel had his lawyer. And that was an awful, you know, even somebody else said once that if that lawyer would have been dressed in a SS uniform, he would not have been better than the way the questions and all that he was asking. And of a sudden, The judge came up. How did I know that the third camp had 27 people? Because I mentioned that my brother was executed there. And I said, I never said that I knew how many. I only knew when they were executed. How did I know it was 20? You know, remember? I asked him in German, would you forget your mother's birthday? He said, no. I said, he was executed on my mother's birthday, the 27th of June. They had it all on paper, everything I said. And then I said to them, you have it all on paper, on tapes, and I am getting older, and you want me to have every detail in my head when you have got it all in black and white. He apologized. But before that, there were other incidents in court. Did I know who was shooting? Then I came just bluntly, and I said to the translator, I said, do you want him to ask or shall I ask him? Would he look back when somebody was shooting at him? I said, I was running for my life. And I said, the first, I forgot to mention it before, the first step, I was outside that the fences. And I said, it's not fresh air, it's free air. And I couldn't care what will happen anymore. I got out of it. And then there was another incident. Did I see the people, they were, you know, the naked, where did I know that the people, the women were taking in Sobibor to the guest chambers? I said there was our toilets, but between the toilets and the barrack, there was a little fence, and it was a brush fence. And when the brushes dried out, we could see through. And coming back from the toilets, even we wanted to look or not, but you're always a little bit, you know, wanted to see things. And I looked through and I saw the woman going there. Then they had a map of Sobibor on a, you know, like the painters have, like a blackboard, but a big map. And he gave me something, you know, to go and show him where that brush fence was. Wasn't like a gate, very little. And I looked at that map of Sobibor. I said, that is not Sobibor. It doesn't look to me, because I know where the rail was. That was on the left, that was on the right, where the barracks were, where the third camp was and everything, but that is not Sobibor. So he walked down from that big, big thing, he was sitting there, and he said he was so sorry, somebody turned the map around. Then they didn't ask many, many questions later on. Oh, one more thing. Why did I, after the war, register myself as the lawyer, Francis' lawyer, register myself as Wojcician and not as Feldman? I said I didn't have any papers, I didn't have anything, who was going to believe me, who I am? Or I said then maybe I didn't want to be Jewish anymore. And that point was that he was going to tell that I wasn't Jewish. I only became Jewish because I wanted compensation, Wiedergutsmachung. I wanted from the Germans. And then I told the dolmetscher and the translator, I couldn't speak anymore to them. I said, could she ask him, would they found a sane man during the war who wasn't Jewish, who wanted to be Jewish?
What happened to Frenzel?
After, I don't know exactly now. I tell you the truth, I don't know if I care anymore, because everybody was called back to give me. He was climbing, he wasn't well, he was nearly 80 years old and all that, but he can't take back what they did.